And I want to wish you all a good evening and good morning to some of you who are across the world, and good night even. Let's see. Today is going to be amazing. By the way, you're listening to The Truth Denied Talk Radio, and I am your host this evening, Roxy Lopez. You know, I want to get you involved a little bit here in some interesting world news. And of course, you all know that our guest today stand against something that they believe is a crime against humanity, which is called chemtrails and geoengineering. I know that a lot of you are very interested in what Paul, Mac, and Max Bliss, who are just amazing activists on the front lines, if you will, really trying to change this outcome. And they do not accept that weather modification or any other type of secret government programs worldwide are going on globally, the spraying that we all see. I want to thank a lot of you for the reports that you've been sending in all week, and very, very interesting changes here in the U.S. as in regards to the type of spraying that's come back. Here in Arizona, in particular, we didn't have spraying for quite some time. We had a lot of dissipating contrails. And interesting enough, that has all changed in the last few days. But I guess we're not anything new. We're finding this out, that some areas of Washington State are seeing these very thick chemtrails, big X's in the sky again, except for some areas of Washington State have never seen this before. I think this is very fascinating, and we're going to delve into the works of my guests. Before that, I want to catch you all up. In the news in the U.S., dolphins dying by the dozens along the East Coast. This is all current today news, by the way. Dolphin deaths along mid-Atlantic state, 7 times higher than normal. Virginia state has recorded 78 dolphin deaths this month alone of August. Scientists investigating respiratory infections of the dolphin deaths. Dolphins send a message on health of environment, scientists say. What's killing the East Coast dolphins? We don't know. And scientists are trying to understand this right now because it is so hefty. Now, we all know that there are relationships between toxicities. I have just given the producer a link for you to expand, you know, read later. The carcasses of dozens of the marine animals, 7 times more than normal, have been washing up on the beaches this summer. And scientists are struggling for answers to the die-off. In Virginia alone, at least 164 dead dolphins have been found this year. And the 78 have washed up in August alone, as I've already said. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, a.k.a. NOAA, has issued an unusual mortality event in response to the deaths. The declaration brings special federal attention to the deaths as something that serves as an indicator of ocean health and may give, quote-unquote, insight into a larger environmental issue, which may also have implications for human health and welfare. And you can also find that on NOAA's website. The current declaration for the mid-Atlantic bottlenose dolphin is one of 60 unusual mortality events the agency has issued since they were established under the Marine Mammal Protection Act in 1991. Causes include infections, now to pay attention, biotoxins, human intervention, and malnutrition. These have been determined in about 29 of the cases. If you want to continue to read the rest of the story, we have given you the link. And of course, we'll be talking more about that on the Truth Denied website. In the Philippines, 7 dead as flooding in the Philippines brings Manila to a standstill. 70% of central Manila is underwater. This is a national news agency report I'll drop the link in for you. You can bookmark it and take a look at it later. This is alarming. 70% of Manila is underwater. All right. The torrential monsoon rains intensified by a tropical storm out over the ocean had already caused significant disruption on Monday, forcing the closure of financial markets and government offices not involved in the emergency response. Those measures continued Tuesday as photos and videos showed floodwaters reaching waist or chest deep on some roads in the Manila region. Of course, the flooding has clogged all the streets of Manila. The water at several dams in the region is reaching a critical level. So the National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council has put out a statement as well. More than 130,000 people have had to leave their homes in the past 2 days and seek shelter with friends, relatives, or evacuations centers that have been provided by Manila. The floods have also prompted airlines to cancel flights and authorities to suspend school classes. Very interesting. I wonder if our guests will be able to comment on this weather that is unusual for Manila. A report on global warming has leaked. The UN panel says it's more certain that humans drive global warming. I'll put a link in. You guys can bookmark this link. Those of you who have tuned in and are not in the chat room, you might want to join the chat room this evening because we have a lot of important news that we'll be dropping into the chat room. Just go to freedomslips.com and hit the chat room and just sign in. So on this report on the global warming leaked, sea levels are very likely to rise more rapidly. An upcoming UN report says scientific consensus is hardening. The report says it's 95% certain that humans are behind rising temperatures, and the conclusions are consistent with those of other recent studies. This is very interesting. Again, my guests are going to be talking about artificial weather. You notice the report, when you read it, doesn't talk about geoengineering, but they do claim that 95% they are certain is caused by humans. I think that's part of a proof factor, if you will, not reading between the lines, if you will. Another one that's very interesting, climate sticker shock. The Arctic thaw could cost $60 trillion. Scientists look at a warming Arctic and see a shift from white to green as the tundra gives way to new plant life. Governments and corporations are also seeing green as receding ice covers open new shipping routes and opportunities to get a long hidden natural resource. But the downside of these opportunities is the risk that current pace of climate change could be sped up dramatically by the release of long trapped methane gas in the region's permafrost, a risk to which a new study has attached an eye-popping price tag of $60 trillion in the next several decades on top of previous estimates. That's trillion with a T, a figure rivaling the entire globe's economic output in 2012. And it's a tab that's far more likely to be paid by the people living in the latitudes far below the Arctic Circle. Everybody should be trying to pay attention to the shifts that are happening in the Arctic and not just leave that up to the Arctic countries and not to some crazy researchers that are in that beautiful white space. We all need to pay attention to what's happening in the Arctic, because the Arctic is the canary in the coal mine. And that comes from Gail Whiteman, who is a researcher at Erasmus University in the Netherlands. By the way, the developing nations of Asia and Africa face more risk of bigger storms, worse flooding, and more intense droughts, she commented. It will have gains for some countries, Whiteman told CNN, but as we can see, if 80% of the impacts are going to be borne by developing regions, they're not getting any of the benefits. Scientists have long worried that thawing the permafrost soil of the high northern latitudes should release large quantities of methane, a greenhouse gas far more potent than carbon dioxide. U.S. and Russian scientists who study the region say methane has already started bubbling up from the floor of the East Siberian Sea, a region believed to hold 50 billion tons of gas. So let's all keep an eye on that. And please go ahead and take a look at all of the links later on when the program is over, or just go ahead and bookmark them. Again, my guest this evening I find to be quite credible, and I also think that they are really doing a great job in the world. Creating awareness is what their mainstay is, and they really get out there and work it. So they're not just on Facebook talking and talking and talking about the problem. They're actually jumping into the solution. I know that I received a lot of emails and Facebook private messages regarding Max Bliss because Max wasn't on Facebook for a while. I tried to explain to people that my gut instinct was Max is probably really busy. And I was right. And those of you who are listening, you know, those are on the front lines of activism. It's getting tougher for us, and we're having to really design, support groups and information groups. And this takes gobs and gobs of time. Paul Mack is a 46-year-old Australian geoengineering and chemtrail activist whose motivation is to spread the word about what is going on around the world and educates as many people as possible regarding the toxic dangers to human and planetary life posed by large-scale geoengineering and stratospheric aerosol spraying. Paul is an activist and has teamed up with Max Bliss and other environmental activists around the world. If you want to see his links, just go to thetruthdenied.com. They're all linked up. Max Bliss joined the British Army straight out of school. After serving 2 years in the British Army and losing a close friend who was killed, followed by a cover-up, Bliss decided to go AWOL for 6 years. This is where he began to ask the question, what's going on in the world? Bliss is a world traveler, a construction worker by trade who spends most of his life outdoors, which is how he came across chemtrails in the early 2012, which prompted him to film the aerial spraying and put the videos up on YouTube for all the world to see. He began the Chuck-a-Boom Chemtrails Awareness Tour and attends conferences in England with other environmental activists attempting to make a difference and create awareness for the public in regards to SAG programs. His group has even confronted the team at the Geoengineering Regulations Governance at Oxford University, as well as many politicians, including the police force. And of course, you all know that Max is very famous on Facebook. The key word here to both of my guests is that they are activists. They take action. They're not only educating, they are seeking to change policy. Because believe me, you, this thing called quote unquote climate change, there are policies and regulations, so please don't tell me that chemtrails and geoengineering and artificial weather does not exist. Don't tell me that. And certainly don't tell my guests that. I'd like to bring onto the show my comrades in this fight. First, I welcome Mr. Paul Mack. Paul, welcome to the show, and thanks so much for being here.
Hey, Roxy. Good to be back on the show, and just listening to your preamble there, yeah, spot on. Don't be telling us that this is not happening because it's blatantly obvious that it is. So,
Yeah, it's pretty obvious. Exactly. And Max Bliss, come on live. Everyone's been looking for you. They're going to be real excited to hear that you're still alive, Max.
Hello, Roxy. Hello, everyone. Yeah, I'm still alive. I'm doing very well. Thank you.
Good for you. Listen, let's bring everybody up to speed. Max, I'd like to ask you a question. I know that you there are stories and rumors, and maybe you can clarify them, about a whistleblowing that you did apparently with a pilot. Do you know anything about this? And if so, can you tell us what happened?
Well, sure. I guess many people will be aware now that I possibly and most likely have been the victim of an elaborate hoax, which I believe was designed possibly to discredit me or the information that I was investigating. But it's been quite an interesting time. I was hooked in quite a bit because a lot of the information that was being shared seemed to support a lot of the research that I was doing. And in fact, it prompted me to research in new areas, which revealed a lot more information, which ironically seems to support a lot of the information that was used to try and create this hoax for me. So to those who did this hoax, I thank you very much. This hoax scenario has not only revealed a lot more research, which I think is very, very strong, it's helped raise the profile of our fight, because obviously to go to such a long drawn out hoax, which went over almost a month, it was quite a big deception. It's put the spotlight on our situation, and it's brought a lot more people's interest to this subject. So to these hoaxers, I am very, very grateful.
Understood. How did you figure out that it was a hoax?
Well, I have to say that when I was first contacted, I was quite hesitant. I was very excited, of course, because I thought it might be genuine, but I was a little bit skeptical. But I don't think I really believed that it was a hoax until that organization that all the activists will know of called Metabunk really went to town to try and expose the fact that they had been aware of a hoax. I think Mick West has tried to say that he has nothing to do with it, but I think with the plethora of activity, it's incredible the amount of activity they've done, it seems to me that they would likely be quite intimately involved, even though they say they're not. But I suppose towards the end, really, was when I started to realise maybe this is this all has been some sort of hoax. Very elaborate. And
right. Yeah, it's unfortunate, Max. And those who know you know your credibility, and I don't think you're going to lose anybody in this. As a matter of fact, I think you nailed it. It all it does is underline what you do, because I don't know if the public is aware, but you are, and so is Paul, that there are industry thugs, industry trolls, industry disinformation agents who are paid by the industry to go out and destroy. And contrail science is, I am sure of it, which is Mick West, I believe, website, is one of those industries who assassinate, you know, your public image. So I think you're right, and I think you've got a great attitude about it. Paul, what's your situation with, you know, when Max was going through this, were you aware as well that, oh my goodness, this is a hoax?
Yeah, well, these things when they crop up, I mean, we're out there actively canvassing for whistleblowers to come forward. You know, we're offering them an opportunity and a safe environment to divulge information to us, some anonymity in that process. So I guess it was kind of to be expected at the end of the day that that somebody would try pull the wool. I've seen a couple of other attempts as well. But at the end of the day, the way I look at it, Roxy, is that, you know, when you look at an aircraft, there's very limited space and systems available on that, purely because of the nature of the beast. You know, it's designed to fly, so they keep weight to a minimum. everything is shaped and formed into certain processes and mechanical processes and so on. So in terms of actual available space on board an aircraft to store chemtrail components and have a dispersal system, you're actually very limited in terms of the mechanical space and avionics available to conceal that and make it functional and also safe. So while we were sort of skeptical of this whistleblower in the process, as Max said, the information that the guy put out seemed spot on. You know, like it was just matched everything that, you know, we'd sort of looked at in the background of where you would store chemtrail components and how you would make that a delivery system. In fact, it's still in my mind probably actually what is going on. And what's happened here is that Metabunk have gone, well, you know, the cat's going to get out of the bag here before too long. Why don't we hide in plain sight? We'll debunk our own hoax, and that way, when the cat does come out of the bag, we can say, oh, we debunked that ages ago. You know, that's the kind of terrorist act that somebody like McQuest would, you know, propagate on us in the activist movement. I think it's 95% accurate with the center wing tank. Perhaps there's also these envirotainers that can go into aircraft holds, which would be very easily filled and hidden off the flight line, then just popped in. Load master handles a connection there, and you know, again, it goes to a spray system. So I think the information that they've given us is fairly accurate, and what they're really wanting to do is just hide it in plain sight and say, oh, we debunked that ages ago. That's my take on it.
That makes a lot of sense, because it throws the baby out with the bathwater. And even though, like you said, a lot of it is actually factual. And so when people see this, report again, they'll say, oh, that was debunked, you know, instead of looking at parts of it. And I'm sure that, you know, you guys will carry on with the parts that are real and get those parts out to the public, because that's what you both do. I'm amazed at the amount of people that both of you, Max and Paul, have brought together in the world under one umbrella of activism when it comes to this. So I just want to say kudos to both of you for all the work and the time that you have invested in this argument, if you will. Now, we're going to come up here on a break in about a minute or two, so I don't want to get too far into this, but I do want to ask if those people who are listening want to get involved with either one of you, well, how would they proceed to join your camp?
Well, for me personally, you'll find me on Facebook through Australia New Zealand Geoengineering Protest. that's our sort of core Facebook group, or the Australians Against Chemtrails Facebook site. Ultimately, you know, we can be contacted at austgeo@mail.com. That's austgeo@mail.com for any personal contacts there. And any potential whistleblowers that are out there this morning and sitting there listening, feel free to drop me an email. I promise that I'll keep your information private and confidential, and offer as much anonymity as I can in the process.
And thank you, Paul. And what about you, Max?
As everyone will know by now, I use Facebook quite a lot, and my page is Max Bliss. So you can contact me there if you want to. I also have my YouTube channel, which is Mr. Max Bliss. And sincerely, I think this experience has demonstrated that if a whistleblower does want to get in contact, we now certainly are better prepared how to receive somebody like that. And I think the time is coming when perhaps it's inevitable that sooner or later a whistleblower will step forward. So we encourage them really strongly, please do. We need you. Mm. So if that's good enough contact detail.
And welcome back to the show. Again, we are speaking with Paul Mack and Max Bliss. very famous individuals who have taken on the chemtrail geoengineering, you know, the big picture here of artificial weather, etc. So before we move forward on that, Paul and Max, we'll go with Max first. Max, what's your overall opinion of what they are doing? What are they spraying? What are they doing? What are they up to?
Well, I'm certain that there's no doubt about it. They're using possibly covert geoengineering as an excuse, as a cover for weather modification. They're forcing the climate, and I'm sure there's many geopolitical reasons, motivations for them, the governments, to be doing this. Our rainwater analysis, like many other people's, have demonstrated that we have higher than normal amounts of aluminium, barium and strontium, which the Wellsback patent suggests that they will be using this for geoengineering. So that indicates it is some sort of geoengineering. But, I mean, basically it seems to me, I've been looking at the plants lately. I've been taking an awful lot of samples, and hopefully we've got a university on board that's going to do a study and be conclusive about this. But we think that there's a link between the nanoparticles that are in the atmosphere that have been sprayed from these planes. They're affecting all the plants, plant life. It's very, very visible here in Europe at the moment, in France and in England, where I've been traveling. It's really, really visually impacting. It's quite disturbing, actually. So we're trying to draw a link between that. I think basically it seems to me that if we can find the conclusive evidence, which we're in the process of trying to establish, then it will point to the fact that they're trying to change our food supply structure, which will mean that we know that there are GMO alternatives that have been quite it's a mature study into aluminium resistance, for example, that which can be used to adapt into any GMO food. So we believe the likelihood is it's about controlling the weather, it's about controlling the world's food supply, and ultimately controlling the people of the world.
That makes sense. That's it in a nutshell, I would say, as well. And Paul, you know, in light of everything that Max has just said, who is doing this? Do we know who is doing this?
Well, that would be the subject of the third film coming out after What in the World, Why in the World, Who in the World is doing this. And it's a deep rabbit hole, and you know, we touched on it last time, Roxy. If we go down to the bottom of that, we're pretty much at the top of the pyramid with the New World Order, Illuminati, and their desire for global depopulation and, you know, controlling that process as it goes through. So it's pretty – there's a pretty strong chain of evidence right up to the top of that little eye on the top of the pyramid. And obviously there's sort of minions and layers and levels on the way down there that, you know, go to the governmental branches that are the functionaries that are instituting this along with military branches. So, I think Max has pretty much nutshelled that. The bottom line is that, you know, there's a handful of evil people in this world, and they've got some pretty nasty designs for, you know, the billions of people that populate the planet that just want to live in peace and harmony and freedom, and they just want to reduce that to you know, nothing virtually.
Yeah, and why do they want to kill off so many human beings? I mean, what would be the motive for that, to actually make people sick and die, rather than just make people sick and keep them on pharmaceuticals so that they could just continue to make billions and billions of dollars off of sick people? Why would they want to kill people?
There's a couple of motivations. I mean, who knows the mind of a madman? I mean, at the outset there, is it just a purely evil intent? You know, well, I think the underscore of that is, yeah, it is an evil entity that wants to sort of make that happen. But these people know that that we're waking up, that there is an awakening happening in the world, and that when enough of us awaken, that there's going to be problems. You know, no matter how many guys they have with guns saying, "We'll shoot us all," they can't get us all in one go. So they're worried that that when we wake up, that we're going to come and get them and get them out of their lofty seats of power and dispense with them and you know try and construct a better world where we don't have megalomaniacs at the helm. So I think that's probably one of their main reasons for wanting global depopulation is that, you know, when we all wake up, we're going to go for them. So, you know, they don't want that on their on the list of things coming towards them. They'll probably have enough enough battles to fight without, you know, every single human being on the face of the planet standing up at once and going, stop.
Absolutely. Are there different agendas, gentlemen? For instance, there's a military document that talks about, you know, the force multiplier. There is, you know, weather, owning the weather by 2025. I believe that's in that document. And then there is weather modification used to drought or extreme flooding. Then there's SRM that they're calling solar radiation management because we're having some crazy cycles with the sun. And then there are cloud seeding techniques, cloud bleaching techniques. There are a number of like Livermore labs and university and a number of very wealthy elites who are putting money into geoengineering, weather modification, et cetera. So my question is just to sort of line this up in people's minds. Are there multi-stacked agendas for this other than genocide?
Well, I'll take that if you like.
Go ahead, Max. Max. Sure.
Okay. Well, I think clearly anyone that starts to research this for themselves, which I would encourage everyone to do, it's a multifaceted program. But as you look into this, you will find that Agenda 21 keeps on popping up, and which is often known as sustainable development. And basically, there is a huge plan that's been accepted by all the governments around the world that they're working towards, which will make sure that all the resources of the planet and all the utilities of the planet come under control of the UN, basically. And if you look at the history of the UN and who set up the UN will start indicating who the people are at the top of this. And I think the people at the top of this have a completely different mindset that would be very difficult for us to actually understand. But looking at their own books and their own research, you can start to understand that these plans are very mature. They've been running for a very long time, and they're working towards a time where they can use science to dominate the whole of the planet. And basically, if we can stop this, they know this. They even talk about it themselves many different occasions. And the only way we will stop this is by recognizing what's happening and taking responsibility and choosing self-determination and working towards exposing it. And that's by raising awareness and by saying we don't consent. We don't necessarily just have to protest, which is making a lot of angry noise. Of course, we should unify and protest, but we should be actually making the effort to say we do not consent to this, which I think is a key thing. People have to research this and understand that you can say, no, we don't want this. But basically, the military documents indicate that they've been trying to control the weather since the Second World War, very in-depth. You can trace it all the way back. Many, many different types of incredible experiments, even exploding nuclear weapons in the upper atmosphere, changing the ionization of the ionosphere. These types of experiments, over 2,000 different nuclear explosions have happened on this planet. These are reckless experiments that jeopardize the sensitive self-regulating systems of our Mother Earth, which we're all connected to. These types of things are incredible, really. And, of course, that's why they're kept secret, because most people would be horrified to realize the true extent of what a small dominating group can manage to achieve on this planet in secret. It's absolutely outrageous that we've allowed a system of government where such a small dominating group can make such massive decisions and even keep that hidden from us and go ahead and do these incredible experiments that have put this whole planet in jeopardy. They talk about the climate change being something that's the cause of man. Well, I think they should redefine that and say the cause of the men running this planet, because there's no doubt about it that they are the ones that are changing the climate. If there's any climate change going on, it's because it's been engineered since the Second World War, and they're trying to use their crazy experiments as a cover to say that it's a natural phenomenon or a phenomenon because of our normal industrial activity, which is completely untrue, and use that as a reason to bring in new laws, bring in carbon taxes, bring in new agendas, and basically create the type of change which can move us to a totalitarian global system which they can control. But we have the power to stop this. We have the power to stop this when we realise what's happening. If you look at the governments, and if we can say, well, are they really behind this? If you look at the UK government, they not only have they done a great deal of research into geoengineering, and they've done their reports, they've set up NGO groups like the SRMGI, which is the Solar Radiation Management Government Initiative, which is a powerful non-government organisation that lobbies different nations to accept the trans-border issues of solar radiation management, which is spraying nanoparticles into the atmosphere. But they say on their website that they have to involve the public because A, they pay for it, and B, they have the power to stop it. Keep them informed on what geoengineering is for, but don't necessarily ask their permission. So there's no doubt about it in my mind, and certainly there's enough documents we can pull together to demonstrate that the governments are pushing this. They're not being completely open about the risks, and they're going ahead of it, but they're obviously, we know now through research, that they're prepared for the risks, as dangerous as they are. And in fact, it really looks like they're trying to force us into a situation where the only food source we'll be able to have are GMO food sources, which they will control through their corporations that they're linked to, and put us in a situation where we won't be able to resist at that point, because you will be dependent on the only food source that will be able to grow in this toxic environment, which they're creating on a daily basis. They're increasing the saturation levels, heading towards a toxic tipping point, which we can establish quite easily. It's not total speculation. And therefore, this is the reason why some of us have been really, really putting as much effort into this as we can, because we're aware of the fact that the clock is ticking. We know that they're trying to lock down the internet. They're trying to, well, they're eroding all our privacies and our perceived freedoms on a constantly. And therefore, all the while they keep us confused and distracted, their plans, their agendas are just going along like clockwork. They're heading towards where they want to be. And, you know, we might be distracted and not really focused. But if we can focus using verifiable facts and sharing information, perhaps standardizing our information and discrediting all the disinformation and coming together as a group, we can quite quickly focus in on the facts, and then we can organize ourselves and structure ourselves and recruit extra help. And I have to say, the reason I've been quiet is because I've been on the road. I've been in England, and I've talked at a couple of conferences, and a lot more people are coming forward to give us help. We're getting some legal help. We're getting more professional help. We've got a university on board. And I think that as we are raising awareness and we're finding verifiable facts and we're building a bigger, more complete picture, many people from within the establishment are starting to take it more seriously, because I think most people working within the system are actually compartmentalized, so they don't really know the big picture. And they're often stressed and they don't really know, they don't get an opportunity to look at the bigger picture. So what we're doing, our efforts, is actually collating all the information, bringing it together, and we're trying to approach different people that might not necessarily see that information, and they're taking notice of it. So I think that's where we're all heading, really.
That's very interesting, Max, that we as the people, we're assuming that people in government have been versed on all of this. So it's very interesting that you do not, you take that into account and get those in government who need the information, you know, pushing that to you know, give as much, like you said, information. Paul, how do you handle plausible deniability, though? What do you do with that? In other words, here's the information, governor, or whoever you're addressing at the time. And how do you get them to stop something that, A, they don't even know is going on, and B, their answer is designed by higher management, if you will, this upper echelon that rules the world, to just deny the existence? How do you do that? What do you do with that?
That's a good question, Roxy, and it's something that we're faced with on a reasonably consistent basis. A lot of the doors we knock on, we get the standard sort of pat replies, which I think the, you know, the telephone operators, those sorts of agents have been trained and versed in now to say, oh, you know, what you're seeing is just aircraft condensation vapor and, you know, it's nothing to worry about, et cetera, et cetera. So we've got to go beyond the front doors and into the offices a bit more. Persistence really is the key, and as Max just indicated there, he's been getting out around the country doing some conferences and you know, building those conversations in the background in terms of getting people who, you know, might be working in a compartmentalized situation along to an event and giving them the bigger picture. It's all about education. I guess this year for us in Australia specifically, we've really focused on the protest side of things, our rejection of government policies and the denial that they've got going on. But having just come back from the UK and spending some time with Max and Mona and the Chemtrails Project UK guys, it was very, very clear straight away to me that we needed to move into a more educational position for the country, for Australia, and I think that's globally. We all need to probably have a two-tiered approach. We keep the activist approach going, but we also start building community through education and getting, you know, geoengineering conferences, bums on seats and halls filled and people more enlightened and more aware. So when they go out back into the marketplace, they're more confident and conversant in the topic, and that greater understanding, I think, will lead to them sharing more information, them understanding perhaps if they're working in a government situation, just what it is that's going on around them, and you know how they can operate inside of that in terms of helping us and getting information out. You know, we just have to keep going, you know, even though a lot of doors are shut to us and some of those are being sort of quietly locked and bolted because they keep seeing us coming. Persistence is the only thing that's going to win through the day here. And as Max said, the clock is ticking. So, you know, we need more people awake. We need more people to be active and to not be fearful. Don't be shy about, you know, standing up and speaking and talking to people about this, more people getting this information out there into the public domain, because when enough people are awake in the public, that's where we can, you know, have a reverse situation where we've got the upper hand in terms of numbers and pressure, and we can exert more pressure to have disclosure. One thing I have noticed lately is that the rhetoric around geoengineering from scientific bodies and governments is becoming bolder and more clear. They're talking in plain sight on a lot of documentation and web pages. NOAA, NOAA, you know, in the US has just come out and released a report, and they're basically saying that, you know, I think we alluded to it earlier, that, you know, climate change is predominantly man-made, caused by man. It's not anthropomorphic. It's being caused by us. While not directly stating that, you know, it's caused by geoengineering, the geoengineering rhetoric in the background is like I said, just becoming bolder and more it's not proposed, it's what we're doing in the background kind of thing. So I think as they're advancing their plans, we need to, you know, keep advancing ours in terms of just waking people up and having people aware that this is going on, pointing towards that information, and then, you know, getting into a position where we can just start getting into a few of these conferences and putting the facts on the table and, you know, showing the evidence that we do have, which is, you know, hair tests and blood tests and water tests and soil tests, showing those very, very highly elevated levels of aluminium, barium, strontium, sulfur dioxides, those sorts of things. That information being represented back to those people, it's hard for them to deny that geoengineering is taking place. And we need to get to that place, you know, at a confrontational level, peacefully, of course, so that that we can start changing it, you know, start changing how they are attacking us virtually by saying, well, yeah, look, we know, here's the evidence that you're already doing it. Why don't you come clean? Why does not the government give us the disclosure that we're looking for? And the only, like I said, the only way we're going to do that is through persistence.
Correct. And I think that, you know, both of you completely understand that there is a reason why they have these experiments going on, you know, in plain sight, yet they're a secret. Because just like with anything else, when you're using toxic chemicals, when you're activating all of that into the water, soil, food, air that we all breathe, there's a financial liability associated with it, which is why when you brought up GMOs, it's the very reason that Obama created the Monsanto Protection Act. I mean, here in our country, we're trying to fight GMOs and just get labeling on the food. And he goes and puts out a Monsanto Protection Act so that they are exempt from any lawsuit against them. And, you know, so the writing's on the wall. We can clearly see why would somebody do that when we already know that GMOs themselves are not good. And then, of course, you know, Monsanto's slogan is, quote unquote, we feed the world. They feel they're going to save the world. And that's not true either. And so with the idea of the dangers of geoengineering, the dangers of augmenting weather, the dangers of putting chemicals of this nature into our world massively. It's not like it's just one little state or a corner of a country. This is global spraying. Do you have any answers for me as in regards to what are the countries who do not want to participate, meaning their governments? What's happening to those countries? Because I know there are a few who will not tolerate GMOs or weather modification programs or whatever else they're doing, SAG, SRM, and you name it. Have you run across any of this? And if so, can you share that information with us, either one of you?
One for you, Max.
Okay, well, I would dearly actually like to talk to countries, to ambassadors or whichever network I could talk to, because we know that countries like Iran and Syria, which the foreign policies of the West have made the enemies, They have openly talked about the fact that their weather systems are being manipulated so that they have problems producing their own food and supply of water. I believe that the deceased leader of Venezuela, Hugo Chavez, he openly stated that he did not want his country to be sprayed with chemtrails. Although I can't speak Spanish to decipher the YouTube videos that you can find to corroborate that. There are countries that don't want spraying and that are aware of it. I haven't actually managed to make any contact with those. It's just information I've got. I mean, the former leader of Iran openly said that their rain is being stolen. And, you know, it's quite obvious, really, that we can see that weather modification is going on almost legitimately. Actually, what is going on legitimately, there are hundreds of companies that are doing weather modification, which I'd just like to actually say about weather modification. Even if you're doing cloud seeding, and whether it's not to create rain, precipitation, or whether it's to reduce it, to keep it dry or whatever, if you modify the weather in one area, by proxy, you are modifying the weather in another area. If you're promoting rain to fall early, then that rain should have continued somewhere else and fallen in another region. So if this is going on in hundreds of locations all around the world, which we know it is legitimately, that's upsetting the whole balance. The planet works as an organism. It's a self-regulating organism. So this is crazy stuff. As far as answering the nations, I mean, the problem is most nations are brought under the wing of the umbrella of the United Nations. It's a very powerful group. And if any nation wants to speak out against the United Nations, history has proven that they will suffer economic sanctions in one way or another to try and bring them into line. There's a man called John Perkins who was an economic hitman, and basically his job was to go to different nations who weren't fully on board with the bigger picture and try and put economic pressure on them. And if that doesn't work, then the next stages are to create wars. And I think if we're honest and we look at the amount of coups that have been attempted by joint nations, I think it's 50 plus around the world, that MI6, CIA, Mossad, and all the different agencies, probably one agency really, have been involved in. So basically there's a lot of pressure on countries that are willing to speak out, and those nations that do speak out seem to get demonized, get put on that list, the axis of evil, and basically are subjected to lots of media coverage and propaganda and demonized. And we're in a situation where any nation that's brave enough to stand up against this this dominating force on the planet, they get the full brunt of their persuasive ways. So I think that, yeah, it'd be great to contact them directly. But the way that we're going to change the situation is actually by reaching out to all the people and educating them, and more importantly, reaching out to people within the establishment, because we're never realistically going to have a revolution and stand up against this system that is so slanted and skewed against us, and is probably even provoking us to do this. We're not about that. What we're about is actually getting people within the establishment that might not know the truth.
And welcome back. You know, we just put a HARP document into the chat room as well. You might want to take a look at that as well. And yes, of course, we are on Twitter. It's The Truth Denied. And go ahead and tweet your questions if you want there, anywhere you want. I mean, we're just about everywhere as far as getting your questions to the guests this evening. So no problem. And yes, and thank you to the listeners for your support. We certainly appreciate some of the comments that you're making at this point, and the support for the guests. They need support, of course. And speaking of that, that is a question that I have for both of you. How do you keep moving forward? How do you keep up the good attitude and the comradeship and the growing numbers of activists that you both have? And I'll start with you, Paul. How do you do it? Where's your sanity in all of it?
Some days, yeah, it can be quite insane. But look, at the bottom of everything, Roxy, I'm kind of the guy who just loves people naturally. I mean, you know, I find great joy in people's freedoms and expressions, and you know, the way a well conducted life is led and put out there. And you know, I think you've got to have a heart for people to be to lead in terms of activism, and you've got to have a heart for the planet. I mean, they're destroying us. Make no doubt about it. They are destroying us. Their mission is to get on top of us, and my mission is to combat that. Is to beat that. You know, And to do that, we need people. So I guess in the background, just through the years, different things in roles and jobs and things that I've done in life has kind of led to this place where all of those tools and everything can be put together in terms of being, you know, an activist leader and trying to, you know, lead people into terms of knowledge and waking up. So it's kind of more like I was built for it than anything else. But you know, having a heart for the people and a heart for the planet and a heart for freedom is the momentum and motivation that drives me, gives me energy. I've been flat out doing this for almost 2 years now without, you know, really too much of a break in between. And, you know, every time I get with a bunch of people and see them stepping up to speak out and you know, be active and create another voice that brings energy to the situation, I get energized. You know, I love seeing that. I love seeing people stepping out of their comfort zones and growing and you know, challenging themselves to be a better them. And I encourage that everywhere I go, you know. And as I said just recently, you know, I was in the UK with Max and the guys over there, and the warmth and the love that I was received by when I was with them was just amazing. It was just energizing to be with those guys and see what they were doing and you know that I've got brothers and sisters like this all around the world who are doing the same thing, and that drives me every day as well, you know, just to know that, you know, I'm not alone doing this, that there's hundreds of other people out there doing this, and a lot of people are doing it tough, you know, like we're not extremely well financed. This is predominantly all coming out of our own back pockets, and you know, to see people giving at that level because they care, because they want to make a difference, you know, it takes away any doubts that you might have that, or you know, any excuses you might have to not go and do it. You know, I can't not do this because, you know, I just look around at everyone else is doing it and I go, well, you know, I'm just like them. I'm just another person, ordinary person who just woke up one day and saw what was going on and knew that something had to happen. So that's what keeps me motivated and moving forward. You know, that the camaraderie and friendship and love that I've got from people all around the world now is just amazing, and it's inspiring and you know, keeps giving us energy to fuel the fires. Did you get all that?
Yes, I certainly. And Max.
All of the above. They're so well put, Paul. And after meeting you, mate, I can really say you are a kindred spirit, one of my brothers for sure.
Thanks, Max.
To keep going, basically, it's a question of we get a lot of support. A lot of people help us. You know, it's a growing movement. And yeah, we're putting a lot of energy into it, but we get a lot of feedback, and we can see our efforts are providing a response. You know, the response is driving us on. More and more people are finding out about this. We're optimistic. We're finding more and more evidence. The evidence is getting stronger and stronger. You know, the powers that be know that we can do our best to speculate and to postulate and to find evidence. But at the end of the day, without full disclosure, we're always going to be doing the best we possibly can. And that's what we're doing. We're just doing the best we can. We're with so many people we're connecting with. There's an energy that's built up, learning to trust in people. We keep positive. It's probably for me, my life has just kind of shaped me for this. So whether that's coincident or whether it's a calling, I can't really say. But, you know, I'm stepping up. I can't stop, because, you know, when you research into this and you find out enough, you can't really decide, oh, I'm going to ignore this. You know, it's too late for that. This is all or nothing, really. It's too important. And I actually feel... I don't know, we're getting somewhere. And that's the other thing that keeps us going. We're actually making progress. We're actually reaching more people. The types of people we're meeting now, I've had meetings with people recently, we're getting a little bit of sponsorship, once they get the right type of proposals. I mean, we really are using all our own money, and for, you know, it costs a lot of money to do everything we can. You know, it's hard going, but people are helping. I'm getting a lot of help with keeping the van on the road, and it's just amazing, really. It's a privilege, actually, to be doing this. And you know, the thing that really keeps me going is all the people. We are uniting, and I can feel that energy, and I think everyone else can feel it. There's a massive change going on, and we're a part of it. And we just keep moving forward, and we know that if we persist, as Paul says, we will succeed. I have the utmost confidence that we will succeed as a people to free ourselves from this domination.
I agree with you, and I think that you know, I love that you both stand by that we see the change. And then feel the energy of the unified, you know, brothers and sisters, if you will. And we've seen a complete change, you know, all of us have in the last couple, 2-3 years, if you're paying attention. And so with that in mind, you're right. There's an energy. There's a tipping point. There's, you know, we can call it whatever we want to, but that has been talked about quite a bit. You know, even this year on my programs, 2013, more and more positive guests or the information that they're giving is more and more positive. It's like everybody that's, you know, sort of focused on, you know, the world, the planet, and the benefits for the planet and healing the planet and healing humanity, really. They all feel this energy. So I have to agree with both of you that, you know, it wasn't so easy 4 and 5 years ago. And God bless, you know, those who have been doing this for 20 years, you know what I mean? Because they didn't get the luck or the timing that we're getting. So I really appreciate you putting that out there. That's very positive information. A couple of really cool questions that came in. And I know this gentleman, I recognize his name in the chat room, and Charles is asking, so what about the idea of a Faraday cage being thrown around the earth, notwithstanding that nano aluminum is extremely toxic? And then he also wants to know who is going to prosecute them.
Oh, I'm not really sure about
that. So I guess one of you can answer. Yeah, that's so funny. Oh, no. Okay, so let's say whichever one of you, Max or Paul, want to answer the Faraday cage thing. I have a feeling what you're going to say already. And then Paul, the second question that Charles asked of who is going to prosecute them. So you guys just pick a lane and answer it. And so you can each answer one of the questions.
You go first, Max. I'll get the second one.
Yeah, basically, I guess it's interesting that you brought up the Faraday cage, or your Charles has brought up the Faraday cage. One of the main problems that a lot of people probably may not be aware of, or they're starting to become aware of, is electromagnetic frequencies and the radiation from the electromagnetic radiation smog that we're all exposed to. You've got mobile phones, you've got cordless phones, you've got Wi-Fi. And, of course, you've got HARP. And all these things are extremely detrimental to our health, to the health of plants, to the health of bees, to the health of the dolphins that you were talking about earlier, the whales. So we do need to be aware. We need to actually move away from the iPhone apps, and we need to actually learn to realize that Wi-Fi is extremely bad for us. Mobile phones are extremely bad for us. It's part of their weaponized system to attack us on another level. Because it's invisible, people are quite often unaware of it. And, of course, it's so convenient and so useful. But basically, I'd like to see all the ionospheric heaters, and there are many of them around the world, shut down permanently. We don't need them. There is no benefit to us for them. We must shut down the NEXRAD, the HARP, the cell towers, the plasma antennas, the ionospheric heaters. You know, it has to stop. A Faraday cage would be very nice, but it's a bit like the run and hide scenario. it's okay for a while, but we really need to just get to the actual problem that's causing the symptoms, which is this incredible leap into science that they've known about for over 100 years, that they've been developing incrementally, and we need to stop this. It's incredibly dangerous, and this is an integral part of the chemtrail story, because obviously they use HAARP to control the weather and for many other incredible agendas. And we could probably spend the whole evening speaking about that, but I think that's an important thing that we have to understand. We're going to have to come to terms with the fact that they've given us certain temptations and benefits of using their technology, which is actually very, very harmful to us. And we need to, at some point, address that, understand it, and learn to realize we're going to have to live without it, or live with some type of altered technology that's safe for us. So I'll leave that with you, Paul.
Yeah, I agree. I agree. And just as a caveat, and then we'll see what Paul has to say about who's going to prosecute them. But, you know, you were talking, Max, about, you know, shut this down permanently. And, of course, the Carrington event of the 1800s would shut the grid down permanently, you know, a good size X flare. So you never know. It could get all shut down. Paul, what about who is going to prosecute them?
Well, that's going to come down to us, Roxy. It's we, the people. You know, we're building organizations and communities right now, and numbers are coming into those communities. And it's going to be up to us to bring about a peaceful confrontation with governments. We're going to have to launch a legal action, a class action, if you like. And, you know, be well organized in terms of the information that we present there. Stuff is being put together in the background with the International Directive to Ban Geoengineering. That's a document that's being worked up to be used worldwide as a presentation tool to governments. And that's how it's going to have to happen. These guys are not going to self-regulate. They're not going to shut themselves down. We're going to have to do it by, you know, mounting a challenge and standing up to them, literally. And that's why we're building community. That's why we focus on building communities, because it's the people around us who have resource and skill sets. And as they awaken and come online, especially those that are working in institutions and things like that, we've got assets there that we can use to assist us and equip us to get to this point. You know, we have a mounting pile of you know, documented evidence, and we're looking to ultimately a court action, a class action at the end of the day, to present that and use that as, you know, a tool to bring about government disclosure. So, you know, it's us who's going to prosecute them in terms of getting this thing on the road and moving. So, and I'm confident, and, you know, we talked about a global tipping point earlier. The clock is running on their side, but it's also running on our side. You know, we are moving forward. We are getting information. We are getting the tools and equipping that we need in the background. You know, we could do some more wealthy benefactors to come in and finance us a bit better in places. But, you know, overall, it is coming together. We are making progress, and you know, that's evidenced by the trolls and shills out there getting more and more desperate to, you know, try and discredit us and try and distract us, and the level of attacks that are coming from them. So, you know, they see that we're moving forward. They see that we're making progress and getting to this point of prosecution. They don't like that, because their masters that pay them are not happy, because they see it all happening too. So it's a bit of a race both sides, but the goal is to get to a point where we can launch a class action and a legal action against you know, governments for allowing this to occur in our atmospheres. Nobody's asked the public, the people, for their permission to have highly toxic aerosol sprays, you know, put out above their homes and sprayed on them. So it's going to come as quite a big shock to you know, probably the a lot of different levels in government that A, this is all happening because they're compartmentalised, but B, that there's enough people awake out there that can now, you know, stand up and shake a stick at them. So it's us who's going to do it.
Understood. And our producer had asked earlier, how are there so many people involved, for instance, working, flying the planes, you know, the chem planes, loading the planes with the stuff, making the stuff? How are there so many people? Because this is global and it happens all day long, every day. There are a lot of people involved in this. How is that possible?
Yeah, there are a lot of people involved in it, but maybe not as many as we think. From my point of view, it's a need-to-know basis kind of situation. A lot of this is compartmentalized. A lot of people don't actually realize they're a small cog in the wheel or the chain, a link in the chain. You know, in terms of getting material onto the planes, you know, there's the hoax that came to Max. I mean, that outlined a chain of command there that seemed quite reasonable to the way I was thinking about it all. You know, very few people actually have to be involved in that process. And, you know, those that are, I suspect that they are held there with a really on a fearful basis. They're threatened. That any disclosure would, you know, bring an immediate effect to them. I suspect they're very, very, very well paid people, and they don't want to lose that income that supports their families, or you know, have some threat hanging over their head against their family. So, you know, it's probably not that many people involved, but there's a lot of cogs in the wheels, you know, that don't know what they're doing. You know, people who are making these chemicals in the factory, they're just making a chemical. They don't know where it's going. It's just being shipped off to some front shell company that's set up by the CIA, who then handles that and then you know, sends that off to be loaded into whatever mechanisms are being used for ejection. So at the end of the day, you know, there's a load master on the plane who makes a connection there, or, you know, if it's fuel based, or you know, it's stored on the plane with probably very few people knowing. It's quite possible a lot of pilots aren't clued into it. There's not maybe a switch in the cockpit that they turn on and off, but these things are set off through GPS tracking and locators, so there's an automated process for them. While the pilots up there are obviously seeing chemtrails every day, they may not be aware it's coming out the back of their plane. They're looking forward, you know. So, yeah, there's a lot of people involved, but it's not a huge amount of people. So, you know, through fear-based mechanisms, through ignorance and compartmentalization, I think that, you know, the lid is just being held onto it. I suspect that, you know, very soon we are going to get a few people coming forward and wanting to work with us, and we're certainly obviously encouraging that. But, yeah, you know, it's like pennies are starting to drop around the world, and people are really starting to have some question marks, not only about chemtrails and geoengineering, but if you look around, there's a lot of other activist movements that are waking up and moving. You know, the whole fracking movement right now is phenomenal. Just to see what's going on in the UK, around Australia, and in the US, people really getting up in the grill of everybody there in terms of activism. And you know, we need to join with those guys too and support them, as they need to understand that, you know, it's all connected. It's part of the bigger picture. And as that awareness, that awakening continues to grow, that tipping point will come to us, and the people who are inside the mechanisms that do know, you know, they're starting to realize that we're not going to go away. You know, we're just going to keep coming. We're going to keep marching towards them, and you know, we're really hoping to see some of those people go, well, you know, maybe my conscience isn't that seared after all. I'm going to be held accountable for this at the end of the day, whether it be on this life or another one. Maybe I should step forward and say something now and help these guys rather than hinder them. So that's where I sit with all of that, for sure.
So that's great. And there's different awarenesses out there, too. I would imagine some people who do not have the depth and knowledge, and as you guys do, but nevertheless, maybe get involved and help you with getting out flyers or this and that and learn as they go. And people who are listening, please, you can learn as you go. If you believe in people like Paul and Max, you can sign up to do something, whether it's even getting a flyer that they've got and sending it out to all your email, the email individuals or, you know, your lists, if you will, and posting it on your Facebook pages or what have you. So there are a number of ways that individuals can get the word out. And, you know, if you don't know about chemtrails, or let's say you know about them, and I'm speaking to the public, but you don't know, you know, how to answer questions about it. Well, then that's where you field those questions back to Paul and Max and some of their groups of individuals who take on the questions. So there's always a way. And I think that people do get shy because they don't feel like they can speak on the topic. I had a gentleman who actually thought that, and I thought he was very, very good at what he was doing, but he was too afraid to really address it publicly because he felt he didn't know enough. And I bet you guys encounter people like that all the time. Max, what do you do when, you know, somebody needs to know a little bit more about the dangers of geoengineering or such? How do you explain it to them so that they can sort of understand it and get the word out?
Well, that's very interesting, actually, that you bring that up, because we've just been brainstorming with some colleagues, and we're basically going to standardize all the information that we've established so far, and we're going to make that accessible so everyone can use that.
And thanks again. Max, could you continue? I'm so sorry. We ran into a break. We were talking about, you know, activists, and maybe they don't know a whole lot. And if you guys ever encounter people like that, and what do you do with those who, you know, sort of don't really know a whole lot about it, but they want to help you guys?
Okay, thank you, Roxy. Yeah, I basically imagine, and we've seen the numbers growing, and I think that in the very near future we're going to see a real growth as we approach critical mass. So what we've been working on here is to start to structure ourselves a little bit better, to standardize the information so that we can share it. We're setting up press packs. We're gathering the evidence that we're comfortable with. We're doing online flyers that people can just print them off themselves and use those to share information. We're setting up questions pretty much on the model that Metabunk used. And Metabunk tried to have a series of questions to say, this is what to say to a chemtrail activist. We're actually going to say, well, this is what we need to say to the establishment. This is what we need to say to increase awareness, because basically it's about participation. So we're going to try to organize, we're going to structure this so that as people come to this situation where they want to find out more, they're equipped. We want to empower people. We're going to give them templates for letters that they can send off to various different organizations or departments of the establishment so that they can put pressure on them with an informed position. So we want to empower people but with reliable information that we've standardized, and empower them. We're also looking into, we've got a lot of help right now. This whole situation with this hoax has actually promoted a lot of interest, and basically I think that we're going to be able to expose aerotoxicity syndrome as a cover for the effects of frequent flyers being exposed to chemtrails, which is one of the ways we're going to hope we'll be able to reach people within the aircraft industry when they realize that they are in danger and that they're breathing in the toxins because they're flying along corridors that are constantly being sprayed by these co-opted commercial airlines. Very easily, the process is underway now, that tests have been done to corroborate that aerotoxicity syndrome should be renamed to chemtrail toxicity syndrome, because basically frequent flyers, cabin crew, flight crew, they're flying through toxins, which are being sprayed there for solar radiation management and other agendas. And basically, this is the way we hope that we'll be able to get through to people within the industry that they need to speak out when they realise that they're actually being harmed. They know that things are going on. They're more susceptible to cancer than many other groups. The instances that we're finding out now where pilots are having to put on oxygen masks because they're getting disorientated and they're suffering the effects of neurotoxicity, these effects are cumulative. They can happen at an acute level, and basically, but we're trying to move to things which we can verify that aren't subject to speculation. Because unfortunately, we have to work with the tools that are available to us. And as we're progressing, more tools are becoming available to us. And of course, we're up against a system that is completely geared to restrict our activities. But as more and more people are waking up, more professionals are waking up, more opportunities are coming our way. And the truth is, it's not that difficult to establish the facts. You know, we can work on the fact that many plants are showing signs, so we've got tests underway to establish. There already are scientific journals that examine the effects of nanoparticulates on DNA growth in plants. And we're going to take that step further and just confirm about what the nanoparticles are present in all these damaged leaves that we're finding across all the species. And with frequent fires, we just need hair samples. And I think basically this is going to be a big turning point as far as conclusive evidence is concerned. And until we get these people coming forward from within the program, we won't have full disclosure. But we're certainly getting to a very awkward position for the establishment as our efforts are paying off and our persistence is showing that there is a growing support as more and more people are waking up and willing to contribute. I mean, it's absolutely amazing. As each conference goes by, more and more professionals are stepping forward, offering their support, offering their services, and it's a game changer. And we're hitting that point where we really will put the government into a situation, or the governments, the elements of the governments that are a part of this, they will be isolated and look like the criminals that they actually are. And I think that the support will just grow and grow and grow. So hopefully with the structure that we're putting into place now, people will be able to use this as a resource and find reliable evidence, which they can verify for themselves, because we really do encourage everyone to try and verify what we're stating, because we are ordinary people doing our best. And of course, we could make mistakes. But generally, I think that the quality of the people that are getting involved is increasing, and the structure is being put into place where we can be effective now. And it's all about participation. So we will put action plans into place so that people can jump on board and play their part, whichever level they're willing to participate. But it is about participation. And we see that participation pays off.
It certainly does. Now, you said earlier the goal is to launch a class action lawsuit. Would that be a global lawsuit? And either one of you can answer to that question.
I would love it to be a global lawsuit. Look, I think it could be on a couple of different levels. I think it can certainly be local within a country to confront a government apparatus in terms of a single country. But I think at the end of the day also that it could be a global situation in terms of, you know, we could take something to the UN in terms of the United Atmospheric Preservation Act and have the UN act on it. That's kind of a bit of mud in their eye sort of thing at the end of the day. I'm not sure how effective that would be. But if it's loud enough and it's got momentum and it's mandated behind it, I don't see why we couldn't do that. And, you know, I think we probably should at the end of the day. So, our approach should be to, at a local governmental level, to councils and things like that, to a national governmental level, to an international level, because it is a global situation. It's a global problem. And many, many governments are obviously complicit in it. So, you know, we attack it on all fronts there, Roxy, I'd say.
Which is great. And, you know, there are those who came before us all as far as environmental lawsuits go. And I'm sure you are both very well aware of that. And even at the, well, I don't know, 2 or 3 years ago in this country, you know, the courts are rigged. Any attorney who doesn't have like a lot of money to take it on and present, you know, the actual correlation of illness to the chemtrails, it doesn't even get their day in court. I mean, this is terrible. There have been those like, let's say, Alfred Lambermont Weber, in conjunction with Senator Dennis Kucinich, who actually wrote the Space Preservation Act, and Part Two that ended up just stalling and then just disappearing in our, how, you know, with our laws. They were trying to pass a law. So there are those before us who also went to international courts and attempted to go after the UN for, you know, a number of things. If you look at the Space Preservation Act, it's littered with very important and concerning military and space agencies who are involved in just, oh my God, a number of catastrophic experiments that they're doing that, you know, most people on the planet don't even know about. But my point is this. In order to take it all the way to the top, it sounds like you've got to start at the bottom. But what you just said really prompted something in me, so I just want to be clear. It sounds like what you guys are doing is sort of spread across all levels, all platforms. You're inviting everyone to come in to challenge it, meaning geoengineering, on any level. So if you could get them busy in the courts, in the municipal courts, in the state courts, and, you know, all in the UK, of course, in Australia and New Zealand, you know, you, what kind of court system do you have there? Paul, you can answer that. And then I want to know with Max, what kind of court systems are you dealing with there?
We've pretty much followed the UK model there.
You do?
In terms of, yeah, because we're Commonwealth countries. So, yeah, we're very much in a parliamentary and judicial process following the United Kingdom model. But, yeah, I mean, we need to get it across all avenues and into all different bodies and courts and conferences. You know, the attack has to come on a multi multiple basis on many, many fronts. Not that, you know, our goal is to tie up resources, but
right,
the facts are out there and they need to be presented, and we'll present pretty much to anyone who listens, you know, in terms of, you know, legitimate and legal capacity. So, yeah.
No, okay. And that makes sense. And Max, as far as how did you come across this geoengineering regulations governance at through the Oxford University? And what is your relationship to the politicians there and the police force as well? Because you've mentioned that before.
Before we move on to those, and I will answer those questions, can I just say that in the UK, just like in America and many other countries, we have a law system that is designed to favour the establishment. So we're left with a few options, which is for us in the UK, and I think in Australia, is the common law route and the small claims court and using something called commercial liens, where basically, as our evidence is building up, we're going to directly accuse different airlines and different organisations and put the onus on them with supportive evidence. So that was just something I wanted to add there to the way we're going to attack this. But, of course, that's just one aspect of this. Because
you know, Max, while you're on that, you know, for Americans too, are you talking about, when you're talking about the common law route, are you talking about filing affidavits and then they have to respond, these companies
exactly.
have to respond? Okay, yeah. I know what you're talking about. Interesting, because we're also beginning to use that in the U.S. as well.
Yeah, that's great, because I mean, we are collecting evidence, and it's time to put the pressure on them. You know, it's time to get bold and start pointing the finger, because all the while they've been acting in anonymity, because people haven't been willing to say they're doing it. And so we're
you don't need an attorney to do this.
No, that's right. And you know, we can only work with the tools that are available to us. But what limited tools are there that can be effective if we learn to apply them? So we're going to try and educate people to use that.
I think there are many countries. I think Canada could use that as well. I think there's many big countries that could actually use that. So that is a story for another day. I don't think people know how to file these affidavits against anyone and give them X amount of time, et cetera, to respond, these corporations. So very interesting. I just had to ask you that when you mentioned that. I wasn't quite sure. Thanks for clarifying that. So furthermore, geoengineering regulations governance at Oxford University, what's that all about and how did you discover it and so forth?
Okay, sure. Well, I'd been reading the 2010 report from the British government, from the UK government, from the Science and Technology Committee, and it's quite an extensive report. And this report was their stimulus for an action plan, and that's when they set up the Solar Radiation Management Government Initiative, which was the NGO lobbying group, which would go around the world. Like that, for example, they had a conference in Lima in Peru, where they had all the South American delegates from different nations to receive their conference. And they did one in Ethiopia, exactly the same thing. They invited all the different African nations to come. So this started me down a line of investigation, and I found out that the British government had started a geoengineering program at Oxford University, at St. Martin's College. So whilst I was over here on the previous visit, when I met Paul, actually, I met Paul Mack, we decided that it would be a great idea. I'd already emailed all of the people involved in the program, and none of them would even have the decency to ping back and say, sorry, we're not interested. So I decided they won't answer my emails. Why not go to Oxford University? Why not find out where the facility is and see if the luck is with us? And we might get to have a talk with them, because basically I feel that possibly many of the people involved in climate studies and geoengineering will be, like many people within the establishment and the government, victims of compartmentalization. And they may well truly believe in what they're doing, for they might think they're doing something for the greater good. So I just wanted the opportunity to have dialogue with them and put the concerns, the growing concerns of the public about geoengineering. So I was hoping that we might be able to just go down there and see if we can get a meeting. So we went to Oxford University, and the town of Oxford is basically, it's a very old town, and it's just filled with beautiful old buildings. And a lot of the buildings in the centre of town are campuses for the different colleges. And it's not that easy to find your way around. So we were getting directions from different people giving us information where to go. And when we arrived at St. Martin's College for geoengineering program, it was being refurbished. So we got new directions to another area, and we walked all around Oxford, and we eventually ended up at this location, which had no reference to it that it was geoengineering, but because we knew they were redirected because they were being refurbished, we tried it out anyway, and basically we managed to stumble upon the department that was dealing with the governance for the regulations of geoengineering.
Wow. So
it was really, I guess, a little bit of luck or divine intervention, whatever you might want to call it. But it was really, really very incredible. And we were directed at the reception up to one of the ladies working in this department, and we had a good an interesting chat. I did manage to record a little bit of it, and basically she admitted that the governance, the work on the governance is at an advanced stage, and it's almost ready to go public now. And I believe that the amount of pressure and the amount of work that's going into geoengineering suggests that they want to go public with this. that they want to, rather than covert geoengineering, they want to do overt geoengineering and sort of push on with their agenda. And it was really revealing talking to this lady. And you know, she was very nice, and it was clear she'd never had a visit from anyone. she was really quite surprised. And, well, I don't know, situations like that, they're like turning points. Mm-hmm. Because we were able to get, we were able to deliver them the directive, which some really nice people have been working hard on, Olga Raffa and Alex Longman, and actually more people are working on it now, which the directive is a document that we want to present to the establishment that explains our concerns, the history and development of geoengineering. And so we got an opportunity to pass that on to them and let them know that basically the public are waking up and the deception is not working any longer. That, you know, we're not there to confront them and to create a big problem. We're there to say, listen, you know, you need to realize we know now, and you need to share information. We need to talk to each other. We need to share our concerns, because I don't know if all these people that are involved are aware of the bigger agenda. I think they're just probably working as hard as anyone else is and believe they're doing the right thing. But they need to know what we believe. We've our conclusions, our concerns. And so it's a big turning point, and it certainly is it's a step forward.
It sounds like it, Max, and of course it's a step forward. What are you going to do to prevent the possibility? You know, and I want to know this for our country, and I know a lot of people would want to know this too. What will we do when they, you know, throw this, okay, we're gonna look into this, and we're going to send it, you know, out to our scientists and our labs, and thank you, you know, for your attention to this, and blah, 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 and then 10 years go by of faulty science, and meanwhile, the programs are, you know, basically, this is what happened, how fluoride in the water got away from all of us. And by the time we tried to do anything about it, it's just a way of life, and it's been propagandized, and I'm sure it has been in the UK as well. It's been propagandized that it's good for you and it makes your teeth stronger and your bones stronger, and we all know it doesn't. My point is, how do you get out in front of it? At this point, is that what you feel that it's possible that you are doing? Because it's still in a regulatory stage and they're still trying to figure out, you know, what policies should go with, you know, geoengineering and climate change and experimentation, et cetera. Is this an opportunity for activists to get in front of it and shake a finger at government and say, oh, no, you don't?
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, unfortunately, I think that we are just about at the state. They haven't got the regulation in place yet. The governance isn't set in place, and it's always easier to stop it before it is in place. Once it's in place, it's really, really difficult. Then the thing is, we are lucky enough that we've come across people who are professionals and who have a lot of credibility, and that will be researching evidence that we will be able to really inform people with reliably. Basically, this whole program, which I believe to be a cover anyway, the geoengineering, is a very risky solution to a problem that they're talking about. Global warming, I believe, is a fraudulent claim, which I think can be explained very easily. If you think about the Vikings were growing barley in Greenland up until the 14th century, which proves it was warmer then. Then we had a mini ice age. There were markets on the frozen Thames during the Middle Ages. Basically, it's very easy to realize the Earth goes through natural cycles anyway. But, I mean, that's a whole different talk. But ultimately, the solutions for this fraudulent claim, in my opinion, are spraying these toxins into the environment for solar radiation management. These are highly toxic, and we can establish how toxic they are. We've already collated many, many studies about the negative health impacts, which are irrefutable. We're starting to collect really good information about the dangers to plant life. The reason the bees have gone is because of the electromagnetic smog. It's not to do with pesticides from Monsanto or the petrochemical industry. We can prove that. There are lots of things that actually we're not as helpless as the establishment would have us believe, not at all. And we are collating this evidence, and the evidence is growing. So what we're going to do is put pressure on the establishment, and those within the establishment who are compartmentalized, hopefully, when they start to see this verifiable evidence and start to see the common sense coming through from lots of people that start using the resources that we're structuring and we're putting together that they can use at any point, that it's going to be very difficult for people within the establishment to say that we're going to carry on with the government line, because they're going to start becoming in the spotlight. They're going to move into the spotlight and say, well, they're going to be left with a decision. Do they condone what the government are doing, even though and they will become aware of the risks? Will they carry on knowing the risks? Or will they say, actually, no, the risks are too high and we don't want to be a part of it? So we're hoping that people within the establishment will start realizing the bigger picture from an informed viewpoint and start really disintegrating the power and effectiveness of these people at the top of the establishment.
Which is a wonderful thing, and I love you know, what both of you bring so much positive to such a dark subject matter. So, you know, I want to thank you both and commend you for your tenacity, your perseverance, and all of your efforts that are really truly paying off for all of us. We all get to experience some of the goodness that you guys are prevailing in the world, and you will. I also love that you have changed such as.